Hello everyone, welcome back to this series called Finance Current Affairs. In this way series, we pick up some important financial topics and we try and discuss them with the help of different questions. So before moving on to the first question, if you haven't subscribed to our channel, then please do subscribe and press this bell icon so that you can be notified for all our upcoming videos. You can also join our Telegram group. The free PDFs of these sessions will be available on that very group. Moving ahead to the first question now. Identify the cryptocurrency that attempt to peg its market value to some external reference like US dollar or commodity prices such as gold and try to achieve price stability via collateralization. They might be national currency backed or cryptocurrency backed. So what they are asking? They are asking about a type of a cryptocurrency which is more stable. If we see Bitcoin, it's quite unstable. Every now and then it keeps on fluctuating. Its value keeps on changing. There is a lot of volatility associated with it. So we have to identify the cryptocurrency which is not that volatile, which is stable. And how is it stable? Because it's pegged to some other currency or some other commodities price. And it also has a backing. Some collateralization is there. It's backed by a currency or a cryptocurrency, which basically makes it more stable option. So the type of cryptocurrency which they are talking about is stable coin. So the answer is option E. From the very name, it's clear that these coins are more stable. They are less volatile. They are facing less of your fluctuations. How they are more stable, what is all this stable coin all about, we'll be discussing it further in our session. Moving ahead, why I am discussing it. So recently IMF came up with its Global Financial Stability Report, where there was a separate chapter on crypto ecosystem. So let's see what are the key highlights of this report, which talks on your crypto ecosystem. According to IMF, crypto ecosystem presents some opportunities to the world, but it also poses several financial stability challenges. So ye jo cryptocurrency aayi hai, isne aur nayi opportunities hamare samne laaye hain, lekin uske saath saath kafi zyada risks bhi hain isse associated jo hamari financial stability ko hamper kar sakte hain. To kya opportunities hain, kya challenges hain, hame unke saath deal karne ke liye kya karna chahiye? All this has been mentioned in this report. What are the challenges, what opportunities it is basically providing, and how we can deal with this ecosystem and basically make it more stronger. That is what IMF has discussed through its report. So according to it, the new opportunities which this crypto ecosystem has presented include, first, technological innovation is ushering the new era of making payments. Now you can make the payments, you can get different financial services at a cheaper cost. You will have more access to those financial services in a really very fast manner, and you can even do the dealings across borders swiftly. So earlier, if you have to get access to some financial service for which you have to make payment in international currency, you have to convert that currency, you have to incur a lot of cost, time, efforts, everything is involved. Now using cryptos, you can easily make the payments internationally in a very fast manner at a cheaper cost. So that's the benefit which in technological innovation has come up with. It's a tool for faster and cheaper cross-border payment. Aapko zyada intermediaries ke saath deal karke apni currency convert karake usme kafi fee wagera bharne ki zarurat nahi hai. Aap kam cost mein easily international payments कर सकते हो. Bank deposits can be transformed to these stable coins. आप अपनी deposits को stable coins में convert करा सकते हो और उन stable coins को आप फिर अलग-अलग products खरीदने में, financial services use करने में utilize कर सकते हो. Stable coins allow instant access to vast array of financial products from digital platforms and allow instant currency conversion. Instantly हमारी currency convert हो जाएगी और हम उन coins को हम use कर सकते हैं अलग-अलग financial products खरीदने में. Moving ahead now, although it has brought a lot of opportunities, but this crypto asset market has gone through lots of ups and downs. The market capitalization of crypto assets has grown amidst the price volatility. Crypto assets ki growth hui hai, kafi zyada logon ne isko use karna shuru kar diya hai, but iske saath saath ye bahut zyada volatile hai, bahut zyada fluctuations hoti hai. Ek tweet ke basis pe बिटकॉइन की वैल्यू इतनी ज़्यादा ऊपर चली जाती है और उसी ट्वीट की वजह से एकदम से वैल्यू नीचे भी आ जाती है. So there are various non-stable coins like your Bitcoins. Okay, although at times they offer you a very, very lucrative return, but when adjusted for volatility, actually they are less impressive. आज आपने बिटकॉइन से 60,000 कमा लिया, अगले ही दिन आपने उसमें 30,000 गवा दिया. नेट जो आपको रिटर्न्स आते हैं वो इतने इंप्रेसिव नहीं होते बिकॉज इतनी ज़्यादा वॉलेटालिटी है. टुडे यू आर अर्निंग लॉट, टुमारो यू लूज एंड द नेट अर्निंग विल नॉट बी दैट वेरी इंप्रेसिव. दिस इज बिकॉज ऑफ द वॉलेटालिटी एसोसिएटेड विद दिस क्रिप्टो मार्केट. ओके, अ की कॉम्पोनेंट ऑफ राइज इन मार्केट कैपिटलाइजेशन इंक्लूड इंक्रीजिंग इंटरेस्ट इन स्टेबल कॉइन्स. जो हमारी फिर भी क्रिप्टो असेट्स की ग्रोथ हो रही है इतनी वॉलेटालिटी होने के बावजूद, वो इसलिए हो रही है क्योंकि और ऑप्शंस अवेलेबल हैं जो इस टाइम पे इन्वेस्टर्स को इंटरेस्ट कर रहे हैं क्रिप्टो मार्केट में आने का. वॉट आर दोज अदर एरियाज विच आर मेकिंग इट इंटरेस्टिंग फॉर द इन्वेस्टर्स टू कम इन दिस मार्केट? दे इंक्लूड द इंटरेस्ट इन द स्टेबल कॉइन्स, new technologies that make use of smart contract blockchains like Ethereum and decentralized finance. So let us discuss each one of them one by one. First, talking about stable coins, their market capitalization has quadrupled. इतना ज़्यादा increase हुआ है stable coins में invest करना लोगों का. Tether is the largest stable coin, although it's the largest, but recently we are seeing a decline in this because more new competitive stable coins are emerging. Every crypto exchange is coming with its own version of a stable coin, like Coinbase has USD coin, Binance has Binance USD. So because of this, the competition for Tether is increasing, but still it's the largest stable coin. Talking about what are stable coins, why were they introduced when we had other bitcoins or other such cryptocurrencies? See, one of the major problems associated with cryptocurrencies was the volatility, right? The cryptocurrency prices tend to vary in a short span of time and people find this volatility exciting. But if you are losing out the money because of this volatility, obviously you will not like to go ahead with that. Okay, like Bitcoin, with a tweet, its value increases and decreases a lot. So stable coins lack volatility. The other coins lacked volatility. So stable coins came up, which are without volatility, which are more stable. Okay, they have the powers like that of cryptos, but they offer another benefit. The positive side is their steadiness, their stability. So they are more like US dollar, Indian rupee and other such currencies. So like the value of rupee or dollar does not fluctuate that much as your value of bitcoins, so is that of stable coins. So just like our rupee or dollar value increases or decreases, similar is the change in this stable coin also. Not very major change, not that much volatility is there. Stable coins are cryptocurrencies that peg their market value to some external reference like US dollar or gold price. So what happens is this stable coin value is actually linked to the market value of say gold or say the US dollar value. So if that US dollar value increases or decreases, or if that gold price increases or decreases, then only this stable coin will change. So similar trend it will follow like that of other currencies or prices. Jaise ye kyunki gold se link hai, to agar gold ka price badhega to iska bhi badhega, gold ka kam hoga to iska bhi kam hoga. Isiliye बहुत ज़्यादा इसमें वॉलेटालिटी नहीं होती है क्योंकि वो जो हमारे ऑप्शंस हैं, जो हमारी करेंसीज हैं, गोल्ड है, वो सब बहुत ज़्यादा वॉलेटाइल नहीं है जितना आपका बिटकॉइन है. बिटकॉइन इज अ नॉन स्टेबल कॉइन. ओके, हाउ आर स्टेबल कॉइन्स एबल टू प्रोवाइड यू दैट मच स्टेबिलिटी? ये भी तो एक क्रिप्टो करेंसी ही है, तो ये इतने स्टेबल कैसे हैं? दैट्स बिकॉज वन रीजन इज दैट दे आर पेग्ड टू सच इंस्ट्रूमेंट्स विच आर देमसेल्व्स नॉट दैट फ्लक्चुएटिंग. Second reason is the collateralization. They have a backing. If you are buying a stable coin, there will be some currency kept separately against that. Okay, as a provision, you can say. Then there might be some cryptocurrency which is kept against that. So aap stable coin khareed rahe ho, to us jitne ka aap stable coin khareed rahe ho, utni currency alag se rakh di jati hai, jo usko back karegi. Ya cryptocurrency, zyada amount mein cryptocurrency rakh di jati hai, taki agar stable coin की वैल्यू में कोई प्रॉब्लम आए तो आपके पास वहाँ बैकिंग है, वो इन्वेस्टर्स को स्टेबिलिटी ऑफर करेगी. सो दे हैव अ बैकिंग. जैसे कि हम बैंक से लोन लेते हैं, लाइक वी टेक अ लोन फ्रॉम द बैंक, दे टेक सम असेट एज अ कोलेटरल एज अ सेफ्टी मेजर. सो दिस दीज स्टेबल कॉइन्स एज अ सेफ्टी मेजर कीप असाइड सेट असाइड सम नेशनल करेंसी और क्रिप्टो करेंसी विच बैक्स दीज कॉइन्स. मूविंग अहेड टू द नेक्स्ट थिंग, दैट इज एथेरियम एंड स्मार्ट कॉन्ट्रैक्ट ब्लॉकचेन्स. So Ethereum is basically a software platform with where you can send or receive this cryptocurrency without the interference of third party. So आपको किसी की जरूरत नहीं है, decentralized way में आप buying and selling कर सकते हो cryptocurrencies की. Okay, and Ethereum uses its own instrument. The Ethereum based applications are the decentralized applications that are self-executing because of smart contracts. Smart contracts means that you are using the code-based programs which where using which you can automatically process the transactions. Coding ke basis pe aise programs banaye gaye hain jisme aapko kisi third party ki, kisi exchange ki, kisi ki zarurat nahi hai for exchanging the cryptocurrencies. You can do them yourself. Okay, so Bitcoin remains the dominant crypto asset, but this year we saw a sharp decline. That's because people have started showing interest in more new coins, more new blockchains that use smarter contracts. And the most prominent is Ether, which surpassed Bitcoin volumes trading in 2021. Moving ahead to DeFi, that is the decentralized finance. What is it? We are referring to a financial system where we don't need any centralized intermediaries. So apne aap buying selling ho jati hai, alag alag transactions hum kar sakte hai, kisi intermediary ki zarurat nahi hai. Decentralized, everything is decentralized. We don't need any third party to be involved. We are used to doing everything going through a bank or going to a financial institution. DeFi creates its own system that can function on its own. Hame kisi bank, kisi financial institution pe depend hone ki zarurat nahi hai. Decentralized finance, when we think of that, we perhaps think that it's just buying and selling of cryptocurrencies. No, you can do various other transactions as well. Decentralized finance allows us to handle a number of financial applications like investing, insurance, exchanging, borrowing, lending, and all these things. So what we have seen that decentralized finance has grown over the year to a very large extent. That's possible because there are more decentralized exchanges that allow us to trade in the crypto assets. And there are more credit platforms emerging where borrowers and sellers without the need of credit risk evaluation can borrow and lend to each other. All right, moving ahead now. These were the benefits which we discussed and how the market of the crypto market has been booming over the years. But now let's discuss some challenges, some financial stability challenges which it brings. Aisi kahi risks hain jo isse associated hain. What are those risks associated with this crypto business? First is the operational risk. You are carrying out some transaction, it gets hampered and you are not able to process the transaction because of which you incurred a huge loss. आपने अभी प्रोसेस की ट्रांजैक्शन वो बीच में रुक गई, जब वो प्रोसेस हुई तब तक वैल्यू चेंज हो चुकी थी उस क्रिप्टो करेंसी की और आपको लॉस सफर करना पड़ा. दैट्स द ऑपरेशनल रिस्क. देन ऑब्वियसली साइबर रिस्क्स आर देयर, हैकिंग, कस्टमर फ्रॉड्स, ऑल दीस काइंड्स ऑफ थिंग हैपन विद द ऑनलाइन बिजनेस, सो यू हैव टू इंक्रीज द सिक्योरिटी. Then there are governance risks. There is no one governing this market. The central banks, your country banks are not supporting it a lot. Okay, so there is lack of transparency. And investors have suffered losses as well because of the governance issues. Then they say, okay, you invest in stable coins, we have reserves, but those reserves are actually not properly disclosed. And at times they keep inadequate reserves. Wo keh to rahe hain ki iski backing mein humne reserve rakhi hai, aapne dekha rakhi hai ki nahi rakhi. That's the problem. So this increased trading of this crypto, going for more cryptoization, can affect your capital flows. The people who used to bring in capital flows, invest in other markets, now they will invest in cryptos, which is not regulated at all. So your capital flows, which would have been invested in more better reliable activities, those will be hampered. Then it will create problem for the central banks while they implement the monetary policy or fiscal policy. Using these instruments, at times people might evade the taxes as well. So it's posing overall macro financial risks to the system. Moving ahead now, what is the way forward? What can be done? There is a need of proper rules and regulations to govern this market as well. Policymakers should implement global standards for crypto assets. Enhance the ability to monitor this ecosystem. Hame monitoring iski aur better karni hogi. The role of stablecoin grows. Regulations should correspond to the risks they pose. Inse associated jo risks hai, unko deal karne ke liye hame solutions nikalne hain. emerging markets faced with cryptoization risks should strengthen the macroeconomic policies and consider the benefits of issuing central bank digital currency. Like the central banks worldwide are thinking this can be a solution, central bank digital currency. Central bank khud hi digital currency nikal de taki ye private currencies ko logo ki dependency kam ho jaye. Aur central bank digital currency reliable hogi, it will have the backing of the central bank. So this is what suggestion they have given. Coming back to our question, the answer was stable coins. Next question is also related to this topic. Let's discuss that as well. It says, which of the following risks are associated with cryptocurrency? So we just discussed all these risks. We have the operational risks, associated cyber risk, governance risk, and overall it is hampering the financial stability. So that risk is obviously there. All these are correct. Answer is option E. Moving to next topic and next question of the day. A non-performing asset is a loan or an advance where interest or installment of the principal remains overdue for more than 90 days. Identify the statements correctly related to the classification of NPAs. So let's discuss what are NPAs, what are its major classifications, then we'll come back to the question. Why I'm discussing it? RBI recently came up with master directions related to this. So RBI has issued master directions which talk about how you need to classify these assets, these NPAs type of assets, how you need to create the provision against them, how you need to recognize the income associated. So all the related to them, the master directions are there. Let's discuss only few key points of this set of direction. So first is that it is done to ensure more better transparency and consistency. Isliye ye master directions aaye hain. What they focus on that the income should be recognized in the objective manner than the subjective consideration. Ek objective way mein aapko income recognize karni hai, assets classify karne hai, provisions banane hai. The classifications of the banks asset should be done in an objective manner which would ensure a uniform and consistent application of the norms. So ek objective criteria jo RBI ke through specified hai, usi way mein aapko income recognize karni hai. कौन सी आप इंटरेस्ट या प्रिंसिपल व्हाट प्रिंसिपल और इंटरेस्ट यू आर अर्निंग विच यू शुड शो इन इनकम अकाउंट्स और हाउ यू शुड क्लासिफाई योर लोन्स योर एनपीएस ऑल दोज रूल्स एंड रेगुलेशंस हैव बीन स्पेसिफाइड ओवर हियर एंड दे नीड टू बी फॉलोड ऑब्जेक्टिवली रादर देन पुटिंग अप अ सब्जेक्टिव कंसिडरेशन ओवर इट. बैंक्स आर अर्ज टू इंश्योर दैट वाइल ग्रांटिंग लोन्स रियलिस्टिक रीपेमेंट शेड्यूल्स आर फिक्स्ड फॉर द बोरोअर्स. अब आपने किसी बोरोअर को लोन दिया, वो पे नहीं कर पा रहा, तो आपने और उस पर ऐसे शेड्यूल बनाए कि आपको इसी टाइम पे करना है कि वो कर ही ना पाए. उसके पास कैश फ्लो ही नहीं जनरेट होगा जब आपने उसको डेट दे दी कि आपको उन्हें रीपे करना है. तो बेस्ड ऑन व्हाट आर द कैश फ्लोज ऑफ बोरोअर्स, व्हाट इज देयर पेइंग कैपेसिटी, यू हैव टू मेक अ टाइम फ्रेम फॉर देम दैट हाउ दे हैव टू रीपे. इट विल इंश्योर द रिकवरी ऑफ दीज एडवांसेस इन अ मोर बेटर मैनर. मूविंग अहेड, RBI also specified that how these NPAs need to be classified into three categories: substandard, doubtful, and loss assets. So, what are NPAs? Let's discuss that first. So, NPA क्या होते हैं? आपने कोई लोन दिया, 90 days के ऊपर हो गया, आपको interest और principal amount नहीं मिला. ये हम usually NPAs की definition देते हैं. But there can be other definitions as well, although similar. So NPA is the interest or principal overdue beyond 90 days, or we might have provided some overdraft facility, some cash credit facility, and beyond 90 days it has not been recovered, so that's also out of order, that's also an NPA. Then you might have some bill purchased as a bank or some bill discounted, and beyond 90 days you are not able to recover the amount, that's also a non-performing asset. You might have given some loan for a crop season, for crop production purposes, the installment or principal is overdue beyond two crop seasons. So short duration wale crops hai, two seasons nikal gaye, abhi tak interest or principal nahi aaya. Usually agriculture related loans which you give, this is related to those NPAs. Or if you have given the loan for a long duration crop, then beyond one season if you are not receiving the installment, that's also an NPA. So this is the full-fledged definition of your NPAs. Now talking about how banks need to classify them, see, first are the standard assets. Standard assets are those loans which have not been converted to NPAs. There are chances that you can easily recover them. But what if they turn into NPAs, you are not able to recover them? Then banks have to classify them into three categories: substandard, doubtful, and loss assets. So ye substandard assets kya hai? जो लोन्स एनपीए कैटेगरी में 12 महीने तक रहते हैं वो सब स्टैंडर्ड असेट्स हैं. द असेट्स विच रिमेन इन द एनपीए कैटेगरी फॉर अ पीरियड लेस देन और इक्वल टू 12 मंथ्स, ओके अप टू 1 ईयर, जो लोन्स एनपीए की कैटेगरी में है वो होते हैं सब स्टैंडर्ड लोन्स, सब स्टैंडर्ड असेट्स. Doubtful are those who remain in this category of being substandard for a period of 12 months. So, एक साल तक जो NPA है वो substandard assets हैं. उसके बाद एक साल तक जो substandard की category में है वो doubtful assets हैं. Loss assets, as the name suggests, which the bank think feel that it will not be able to recover, but yet have not written them off. So, they are the uncollectible assets. Okay, if you will realize them also, very less value is something which you are going to recover. Moving ahead now, bank management and statutory auditors are responsible to ensure that there is proper provisioning against the assets, against these NPAs. So you have classified the NPAs into different category. Now against them you have to keep certain provision, certain, you need to set aside certain portion of your income to deal with such losses. Okay, there are chances that the losses may arise when you are trying to recover the loans, so you need to set aside a portion called provisions. So this is the overview of those provisions. Against the loss assets, 100% provision should be created. 100% amount आपको set aside करना है, क्योंकि आपको पता लग रहा है कि अब वो recover होने के chances नहीं है. For doubtful asset, for unsecured ones, it's 100%, and for remaining, as per the time period, different rates have been specified. For substandard assets, it ranges between 15 to 25, and standard assets, which are not yet classified into an NPA category, they again have different minimum provisions to be set aside. Moving ahead to the resolution plan now. What can be done to resolve the stress assets? आपको दिख रहा है कि आपके loans NPA बन रहे हैं या बनने की तरफ बढ़ रहे हैं, तो आपको क्या करना चाहिए उनको resolve करने के लिए? First and foremost thing that's needed is you need to do early identification and reporting of the stress. ये नहीं कि 90 डेज बाद आपने देखा हाँ ये NPA बन गया अब हम इसका रेजोल्यूशन करते हैं. पहले ही आप ट्रैक रखो कि कौन से ऐसे लोन्स हैं जो NPAs की तरफ बढ़ रहे हैं. दैट इज व्हाट वी अकाउंट फॉर अंडर द स्पेशल मेंशन अकाउंट्स. यू डोंट हैव टू वेट फॉर 90 डेज टू बी ओवर टू सी वेदर अ लोन हैज बीन कन्वर्टेड इनटू एन NPA एंड वेदर नाउ यू कैन स्टार्ट विद योर रेजोल्यूशन और नॉट. Beforehand only you need to see which loans are approaching towards becoming an NPA and take the steps for resolution beforehand only. Okay, there are chances of certain loans that they will soon be under the default category or soon they will become NPA. So account for them before only. So when you account, where you account for these kinds of loans which are showing symptoms of being a bad assets in the first 90 days, the accounting is done in a special mention account. So, अगर आप देख रहे हो कि 30 दिन हो गए अभी तक हमारा लोन नहीं रिकवर हुआ, उसको आप SMA 0 कैटेगरी में डालोगे. देन आपने देखा कि अब 60 डेज होने वाले हैं अभी तक नहीं आया, तो उसको आप SMA 1 कैटेगरी में डालोगे. फिर 61 से ऊपर हो गए लेकिन 90 डेज से कम है तो SMA 2, एंड बियॉन्ड 90 डेज ऑब्वियसली दैट बिकम्स एन NPA. सो यू नीड टू क्लासिफाई देम बेस्ड ऑन डेज. ओके, दिस मच टाइम हैज पास्ड, वी हैव नॉट येट रिकवर्ड, सो नाउ दिस लोन कैन गेट कन्वर्टेड इनटू NPAs. क्लासिफाई इट सेपरेटली, डील विद इट सेपरेटली, ट्राई एंड रिजॉल्व इट बिफोर हैंड ओनली. इट माइट हैपन दैट हियर यू रिजॉल्व एंड द रिकवरी बिगिंस. आपको इसी स्टेप में आपने कुछ मेजर्स ले लिए तो आपका पैसा रिकवर होने लगा, आपको ज़रूरत ही नहीं पड़ी कि वो NPA में कन्वर्ट हो जाए. स्टिल इफ इट्स नॉट पॉसिबल, यू वेटेड फॉर मोर डेज, यू ट्राइड मोर रेजोल्यूशन प्लान्स एंड द मैटर्स गॉट रिजॉल्व. इफ स्टिल दे डोंट गेट रिजॉल्व, फाइनली दे विल गेट कन्वर्टेड टू NPAs. अगर प्रॉब्लम बहुत मेजर है तो वो NPAs में कन्वर्ट हो जाएगी, तब आपको फिर अलग वे में डील करना है. यू माइट हैव टू गो फॉर इंसॉल्वेंसी और सेल ऑफ द प्रॉप और लिक्विडेशन. Okay, so next what you need to do after going for the early identification, you need to implement the resolution plan. You need to have a board approved policy for resolution. Okay, then since the default with lender is lagging indicator of financial stress, it's expected that lenders initiate the process of resolution plan even before the default. NPA convert होने से पहले ही measures लेना शुरू कर दो. In case once a borrower is reported to be in default, then take 30 days and review that borrower. See what strategy you can use to recover the amount and then implement it. If nothing is possible, finally you need to go for insolvency or recovery through liquidation. You will proceed further the case to the insolvency and bankruptcy court, and then the proceedings will go on and they will help with the recovery. Or now we are setting up the bad bank as well. We have set up the NARCL, so it will further then help up in the recovery. Okay, so this was all that I wanted to discuss. Coming back to our question, we had to identify the correct statements. First is correct that banks have to classify NPAs into these three categories. Second is incorrect because it's substandard assets which are in NPA category for up to 1 year. And this is also incorrect because it's the doubtful assets which remain in the substandard category for 12 months. Okay, so first is correct, answer is option A. Moving to last question now, related to this topic only. Which of the following correctly defines SMA? So 90 days से पहले ही जो loans हम देखते हैं default में हैं उनको mention कर देते हैं, वो accounts SMAs होते हैं. So they are the assets that show symptom of bad quality in first 90 days itself before we classify them into NPAs. So this was all for today's session. I hope you found the session to be useful. With this, I would like to end up this session. Thank you so much.